Surely that can't be the only reason that we've come into existence. That can't be the only reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent 124,000 prophets. That He revealed a book that has more than 6,200 verses. The amount of sacrifices that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through just to spread the message of Islam couldn't have just been so that we just do the bare minimum. So I started asking myself a question that it can't be true that only those individuals who go to Najaf and Qum for their Hawza studies, only they are entitled to know about Islam. It might have been true 20 years ago where you actually had to make that physical journey and leave your house and go and study there full time. But in this day and age, with technology, with access to abundant knowledge about Islam, we don't have an excuse where we can't learn about our Islam religion. To the extent that we learn as much as possible that is taught in the Hawza. So I started asking myself, there must be a way where without leaving the comforts of my home, I can try to learn about Islam in a structured manner. See, the problem with us is that we all know a lot about Islam, we all know things about history, about akhlaq, about ahkam, but we don't know it in a structured manner, and that's very important. That's what is taught in Hawza. So I started researching online to find out, is there a program anywhere on the internet that allows you to obtain the Hawza studies while staying at home? And I would say that maybe it was Tawfiq, and you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw that I was serious about this, that I came through this website called ehawza.com.
Yeah.
Again, Google searching, researching, and I came across this website. Now from the name of it, you can tell definitely it's about Hawza. It's ehawza, so it's definitely electronic. So I started researching on this, and it is a platform that was started by an individual called Sheikh Mansoor Laghai. He is an Iranian scholar. I will come about his details a bit later, but basically, that's it. So what he did was, he completed his studies in Qum. He's a proper Islamic scholar, and then he was posted to Australia in 94. He started an Islamic Imam Hussein Islamic Center. He enlarged the Shia community, and then he started this ehawza program. What this program does, it provides a concise version of traditional Hawza studies in the comfort of your own home. And the main mode of teaching is English. See, the problem is when you go to Hawza, you have to spend the first 6 to 9 months, and Maulana Sahib can correct me on this, you have to spend at least 6 to 9 months learning Farsi.
Six months
to learn Farsi. Then you have to learn the Arabic language. So it takes you at least a year and a half, 2 years, until you actually start reading actual content, actual text. And that's something which I wanted to bypass, because I did not want to learn Farsi. I wanted to start learning about Islam in the English language. And I found this website. So what this individual has done is he has created a diploma program, which is called Diploma in Islamic Theology. And there's a Bachelor's in Islamic Studies, the major in Fiqh, in Analytical Fiqh and Tafsir. The diploma consists of 4 semesters. I have completed 2 semesters since 2017. Because I'm doing the part-time course, and they give you 9 months to do each semester. And I'm currently on my 3rd semester. So while I was learning this for the last 2 years, I've come to a point now where I feel that the knowledge that I've gained, I want to start sharing that with the community. And that's what the Sheikh encourages also.
Mashallah.
Don't just keep it to yourself. Start sharing it with people who are interested. And because I've been following a structure, it's much easier to share it. But then I guess your question now is going to be, well, who is this individual? Naturally, you know, I mean, I'm sitting here, not a scholar, and I'm going to be providing with content which you don't know is credible or not. If, when it comes to rules of fiqh, you don't know whether what I'm saying is true or not. So you naturally want to know, is this person credible or not? So who is he? So he basically completed his studies in Qum. He did a PhD in Islamic Theosophy from Qum. In 94, he was sent to Australia to spread the message to Tabligh. He founded Islamic Hussein, Imam Hussein Islamic Center in Sydney, and he created this program. But again, he's just an Islamic scholar. So you might say, well, there are lots of Islamic scholars out there. some are credible, some are not. So how do we know that the content that this person has created is credible? So what I've got, and the best way that I can give you assurance that this person and the content he's provided is credible, is to tell you who his teachers were. So Sheikh Mansoor Lagai has had the honor of being taught personally by the following individuals. He was taught by Grand Ayatollah Nasir Makarem Shirazi, who was a Marja. For 5 years, he learned Usul al-Fiqh from him. He learned under Grand Ayatollah Wahid Khorasani, who was also a current Marja, and he learned Usul al-Fiqh for 1 year. Personally, he learned about Fiqh from Ayatollah, Grand Ayatollah, late Grand Ayatollah Sheikh Jawad Tabrizi, who was also a Marja. He learned the science of Hadith and Rijal from Grand Ayatollah Musa Shulayz.
What this is trying to tell us is that if you gain knowledge, you can actually understand the actual reality about what's around you. All the ayat that you have in front of you, the sun, the moon, the sky, the earth, and all the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. If you have knowledge, you can actually understand the true meaning of what that is. And you can see the true signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only if you have knowledge. But at the same time, the Quran says, إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَّابِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ صُمُّ الْبُكْمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. Indeed, the worst of living creatures in the sight of Allah are the deaf and dumb who do not use reason. So, Quran is admonishing you that if you do not obtain knowledge, you are just like a person who is deaf and dumb. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says,
Allah,
Allah, Allah,
Allah, Allah, Allah.
In Al-Kafi, it is mentioned that he says that seeking knowledge is obligatory for every Muslim. Let it be known that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who seek knowledge. Imam Ali alayhi salam says in Al-Kafi, people are of three kinds. They are either scholars, they're learners, or they're scum. And the reason that he used the word scum is to tell you that if you're not a scholar and if you're not a learner, you're the worst of the worst in your society. So the least you can try to do is become a student of Islam and learn. And I'm sure most of our great alim-e-deen will say that they don't even consider themselves scholars. They're all students. So it's enough for us to just call ourselves students, but we need to embark on that journey. So what is going to be the structure of the Islamic studies that hopefully inshallah we will embark on? We are going to start with a course on jurisprudence of worshipping, which is Fiqh al-Ibadat, because it is the needs of our society, as Maulana has rightly mentioned, that we need to learn about the actual fiqh of our worshipping. How to pray? What are the rules regarding going to the lavatory? What are the najis things? What are the things that make tahar? What are the things that make something pure? What are the rules regarding fasting? What are the rules regarding dress that you have to wear while praying? All these things which you will find in the Tawzi'ul Masail of your Marja' Taqleed. But through this structure, you can actually understand and know these things by yourself. And I'm sure we all know them right now. We all know these things, here and there, we all know everything. But this structure will provide you with the right knowledge to be able to perform your obligatory duties correctly. Then we will have a course on Introduction to Islamic Studies. We will have a course on Islamic Theology. And then there's going to be a very interesting course on Roots of Sunni Shia Division. I will come to that later. We'll have a course on the Ahlul Bayt, Salamullah Alayhi, a course on all the Masuneen. There'll be a course on Fiqh, on the Laws of Transactions. There'll be a very good course on Ancient Prophets for a Modern World. There'll be a course on Philosophy of Religion, a course on History of Islam, Arabic Grammar, Interpretation of the Holy Quran, Formal Logic, which we call Mantiq, Islamic Philosophy, Sciences of the Quran, Sciences of the Hadith, Analytical History of Ashura, Imamat in Islam, Principles of Jurisprudence, Introduction to Islamic Irfan. And if I get good feedback from this, and if people actually get interested to know these things, there is an amazing course that hopefully we can embark on, which is called Practical Irfan. This course has honestly had a big, significant impact on my life. And it deals with changing your nafs and changing yourself inside and what are the activities you need to do to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But to give you an example of what are the kind of things we will learn in any of these courses? See, remember, these are courses which have individual classes in them. And I know that people will find this course on roots of Sunni Shia division interesting because it's something that is talked about. What are the things we will discuss in this? We will discuss what is the origin of Shia. We will discuss the concept of leadership. Is our Quran the same? What is Tawassul? Why do we believe in Tawassul? Who were the companions of the Prophet? What is Ijtihad? What is the prophetic way of doing the wudu? What is the prophetic way of doing prostration? Why do we combine prayers? What is Taqiyyah? How is Imam Mehdi ajallahu ta'ala forever going to come and be that Allahumma salli ala
Muhammad?
I'm going fast because I don't have enough time. But there's going to be a course on how he is going to be the ender of all the divisions, inshallah, when he reappears. What are the main roots of our differences? There's going to be a course on the analysis of the Sahihain, which is the two Sahih books. What is the leadership of Imam Ali in those books? What does it say? And then we're going to have a course on Ayat Taqeed. These are individual courses. This is not one course where we touch on these things. This is each individual thing is one course, which is going to range from about half an hour to 1 hour. So we can inshallah finish this course when we get to it in a week, or well, depends how many lessons we have, it all depends on you. But this is each individual lesson, not just one lesson which touching all these things, because there's a lot of detail in each of these lessons. The main objective that I have is in the e-hoza, as I mentioned, you can do a diploma and then you can do the bachelor's. E-hoza allows you to get into the bachelor's if you finish the diploma, but you cannot enroll in the bachelor's without having the diploma unless you can pass an entrance exam. So my objective is that inshallah, by going through all these courses, that I will be able to impart all that knowledge that you might have, that if you are interested to do a bachelor's in Islamic studies, you will have the knowledge to pass that entrance exam and do this bachelor's online. So hopefully when we start, inshallah, I would request everyone bring paper and pencils so we can make notes, and I can share these slides with you as well, but there'll be a lot of talking that I'll be doing which you can make notes on. And I don't at the moment plan on having exams, but it's something we can have assessments later on to decide where are we at the moment. So to start off with, in Islamic studies, the first thing we need to make sure is that our intention is pure. We need to make sure that we are only learning about Islam for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No reason whatsoever. It shouldn't be to show off. It shouldn't be to have a standing in your community. It should only be so that you can get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our fourth Imam, Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, says,
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
He says that no action will be accepted without the right intention. Our sixth Imam, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, says, if you ask me why people of hell are in hell, it is because that was their intention. What he means by that is that if there was no Jahannam, if there was no Jannah, and this world was to go on forever and ever, these individuals would continue sinning because that was their intention. So our intention is very important when we embark on this process, that we do it only and only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have to remember that it is a means and not an end. You will continue learning, we will continue inshallah learning throughout our lives. There's not going to be a point where we will say we know everything. There's a there's a verse in Surah Maida which says, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu alaykum anfusakum la yadurrukum man dalla iza ihtadaytum ilallahi marji'ukum jami'an fayunabbi'ukum bima kuntum ta'malun. O you who have believed, upon you is responsibility for yourselves. Those who have gone astray will not harm you when you have been guided. So rest assured, when you get the knowledge, first make sure that you improve yourself and don't worry about the effects that shaitan is going to have on you, because you will be on the path of guidance. Imam Rida alayhi salam narrates from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa
sallam.
He narrates from the Prophet that the creation are the dependents of God. So the dearest person to God is one who pleases a believing family. Which means that if you have the knowledge, it is incumbent upon you to share that knowledge with fellow Muslim and fellow Mumineen. So the issue that we have right now is that there's a gap between knowledge and practice. We know certain things, we perform certain amal. But unfortunately, the problem is that we are not in a situation, at a position where we are following everything that we know. Imam Khomeini states that to become a scholar is difficult, but to become a practicing scholar is almost impossible. So what we need to do is, while we are learning, we need to add some mustahab in our daily diet, spiritual diet, and we work on iman. The actual meaning of mustahab is seeking the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So remember, anything that you do which is not obligatory, you're doing it to gain this love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't know if you can see this. What I'm trying to show here is that we are currently a little bit on that side and a little bit on that side. The left side is your knowledge and the right side is your practical, is your practice. What we want to aim is to bridge the whole gap and cover that whole bridge, inshallah. We learn and we practice what we know. Islam is a dispensary of medicine to cure spiritual ailments. But remember, self-taught learning can be dangerous also. So we need to have a mentor. And mashallah, we have Maulana Sahib here who can be our mentor, who we can go to for guidance and to obtain more knowledge. So, what I want to present now is very, very brief introduction of Islam, assuming none of you know anything about Islam, because we're going to start right from the basics. So please excuse me if you find this very basic. We all know all of this, but it is important we start with this. So in a nutshell, the Islamic greeting is Salaamu Alaikum, which means peace be with you and peace be upon you. It is a very specific and prophetic way of greeting. But why Salaamu Alaikum? Why peace? We look at the origin of it. We look at a Quran ayat in Surah Hashr, chapter 59, verse 23, which says, هُوَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْمَالِكُ الْقُدُّوسُ السَّلَامُ الْمُؤْمِنُ الْمُحَيْمِنُ الْعَزِيزُ الْجَبَّارُ الْمُتَكَبِّرُ. Allah is He, than whom there is no other God. He is the Sovereign, the Holy One, the source of peace. So that's the first reference in Quran of what Salaam means. There's another verse in Surah Al-Anam, verse 127, that says, لَهُمْ دَارُ السَّلَامِ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. For them will be a home of peace in the presence of the Lord, which is talking about paradise. There's a third ayat which talks about, I'm going to skip the Arabic, between them shall be a veil, and on the heights will be men who will know everyone by his marks. They will call out to the companions of the garden, peace be on you. And the last verse is, when they entered his presence and said, peace, he said, we feel afraid of you. This ayah refers to when the angels descended upon Prophet Ibrahim in the guise of humans. They said Salaamu Alaikum to the Prophet. So what do these four things tell us about the greeting that we say on a daily basis multiple times? We know that is the name of Allah. So when we actually say Salaamu Alaikum, we are invoking the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are reminding ourselves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the name of paradise. If we want to gain access to Jannah, we should always remember when we say Salaamu Alaikum that it's also a name of Jannah. It is a greeting in heaven. If you want to be the companions of heaven, every time we say Salaamu Alaikum, we should remind ourselves that we want to be the companions of heaven. And lastly, it is an angelic greeting. It is a greeting of the angels. One thing I want to note here is that throughout this whole course, inshallah, we are not going to provide you with specific rulings of the Shaykh, because he is not a mujtahid. We are going to provide you with the views of the various different eminent scholars currently in the Shia world. One thing I should note, interesting fact, in the Gospel of John, in the Bible, chapter 20, verse 19, it says that on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and says, peace with you. So this is not just a Quranic thing, it is something found in the Bible also. And remember that replying to a salam is wajib. We all know that. And peace be upon all of us who inshallah will follow guidance. So, what is Islam and who is a Muslim? To start off with, Islam means absolute submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His commands. And therefore, a Muslim is someone who has submitted himself absolutely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's commands. We know that. That's what we do. And there's an ayat In Surah Maidah it says, "This day have I perfected your religion for you, completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you Islam as your religion." This is an ayat that was revealed at the time of Hadith. But what this ayat is telling you is that Islam is our religion, which means we have to submit ourselves completely. Fair enough. But then what is Iman? We have Islam, but then we have Iman. You have a Muslim and you have a Mu'min. So what are the differences apart between a Mu'min and a Muslim? There's an ayah in Surah Hujrat which says that the desert Arabs said, "We believe. Say you have no faith, but you only say, we have submitted our wills to Allah." What that means is submission to Allah from our mouths is something. But what Iman says is that when that submission turns into full realization of the faith, into our actions, that's when you become a Mu'min. So we can all be Muslims, but not necessarily all be Mu'mins until we have taken that submission and converted it into our actions, where we can show that yes, we do pray, we do fast, we read the Quran, we give zakat, we give khums. But are we just doing it because we've been commanded to, because we are born in a Muslim family, without actually understanding what's the reason behind it? Do we actually even believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we actually even believe in the Prophet? Do we even believe in the last day of judgment? Or are we just doing this because we've been told to by our parents? So when we actually start learning about Islam and understanding that everything we're doing right now, there's a reason behind it, and we then start increasing our faith, then we can call ourselves Mu'min. Remember that you can be a Muslim without being a Mu'min, but you cannot be a Mu'min without being a Muslim first. There's a definition of Islam by Imam Ali alayhi salam in Al-Kafi, which he says that I shall certainly define Islam a definition that no one has ever done before. Islam is submission. Yes, we know that. What is submission? Submission is certainty. It is yaqeen. You will only submit to something when you have yaqeen. Yaqeen and certainty is acknowledgement. You will only have yaqeen when you have actually said, yes, I do believe in this. Acknowledgement is confession. Confession means action, and action means deliverance. So he's taken you through a whole step of what is Islam. You have to first have yaqeen, then you have to do tasdeeq, and through tasdeeq you are showing your actions, because just saying I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not enough. You have to show it through your actions. And if your actions are those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects from you, then you have obtained deliverance. Then you're on the path of guidance. There's a story where the companions of Imam Ali alayhi salam were debating tajweed, how to recite Quran. And they were debating about the pause, should it be 5 seconds, 4 seconds, 6 seconds. And then Imam Ali says that you spend all your life correcting the grammar of your speech, but not the grammar of your action. So we all need to tell ourselves that we need to make sure that we keep looking at ourselves and improving ourselves as fellow Muslims. What is the Muslim scripture? We all know it's the glorious Holy Quran. What does it actually mean? The literal meaning of Quran is recital or recitation. It is the actual verbatim words of Allah. When I say verbatim words, I mean every letter in the Quran is the word of Allah. No omission or deletion, no alteration from a human being. Exact letter and words are Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's. And contrary to what others might say about us Shias, Quran is the same amongst all us Muslims. Our Quran and the Quran of our fellow brothers is exactly the same. There is no difference whatsoever. What is Sunnah? It is the words, the actions, and the confirmation of a Masoom. So not just Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but all our Masoomin. Their actions, their words, and their confirmation. Because at times, they would confirm something to be correct or not by just not saying something, but by just nodding them because of the situation that arose. So those things are also considered Sunnah. Because these two things are our main source of guidance. If someone was to ask you, I give you 5 seconds, I want you to tell me what is the basis of Islam. 5 seconds only. I don't know if you've heard the concept of elevator pitch. You're stuck in an elevator, you have to sell a business idea, you only have 5 seconds to do it. And you have to sell someone, what is Islam? Islam is purely and simply faith and righteous good deeds. That is it. Nothing else. Nothing to make it more complicated. You have Iman, but at the same time you have to have good Amal. They cannot go without each other. You might have faith, but if you don't have good Amal, you can't call yourself a Muslim. And if you have the righteous good deeds, but you don't have the belief in Allah, that is not enough for you. And there's going to be a whole course that we're going to do on the question about what about those individuals who have done so much good in this world but didn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What would happen to them? Will they go to heaven or not? These kind of discussions. There's a whole course on that we will get inshallah later on. So what are the Islamic teachings? There are three branches of Islamic teachings. We have the fundamentals of religion, which we call Usul al-Din, which are made up of Tawheed, Monotheism, Justice, Adl, Risala, Prophethood, Divine Leadership, which is Imamat, and the Hereafter, which is Qiyamah. These are Usul al-Din. The study of this branch of Islamic teachings is called Theology, Ilm al-Ilahiyat. Then we have the branches of religion, the Furu al-Din. Why do we call it branches? You have to ask yourself. Because the branches can only be as strong as the tree itself. So our actions can only be as strong as long as our Aqeedah is strong. That's why we start with Usul al-Din first. We start with beliefs first. And then we get on to the actual actions. So what comes into this is the acts of worship, al-Ibadat. We have bilateral contracts, which are called al-Uqood. We have unilateral contracts, such as divorce, al-Iqad. And then we have general laws, like what's haram drinking, what's halal food, what's haram food. These are called ahkam. This study is called fiqh or jurisprudence. And the third thing is akhlaq, which is primarily ethical virtues and ethical vices. The goods and the bads, essentially, of your human character. Because remember, our Prophet was sent to improve our moral conduct. So just to breeze through the next slide quickly, Islamic dietary laws. I'm sure we all know this. What is halal? Halal means it's permissible and lawful. Haram means impermissible and lawful. What is haram food? Any animal that has died without being slaughtered in an Islamic way. What is an Islamic way? It is cutting of the four main veins, the windpipe, the food tract, and the two jugular veins. It is done by a Muslim. It is done putting the animal facing the Qibla. And it is done while reciting the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Something then becomes halal when you slaughter. The meat of swine, porcine animals, meaning animals that resemble pigs, and pigs themselves, the meat is haram. Seafood, in the Shia school of thought, is all haram except for scaled fish and prawns. We all know that. All types of intoxicants are forbidden, thoroughly and completely. And what I mean by that is that certain times people say that if a drop of alcohol falls in boiling water or in food that is burning, then it's fine because it's going into hot water. No, it's still haram. That's why it's thoroughly and completely haram intoxicants in any shape or form. Islamic social interactions. Interaction with the opposite sex is permissible as long as it's done in a decent and professional manner. Our imams used to deal with women in a decent and professional manner in issues relating to marital life, society, ahkam. So it is permissible for us to do that provided it is done in a decent and professional manner. Who are mahram? Mahram are those with whom marriage is forbidden, like your mother, your sister, your brother. And non-mahram is those with whom marriage is permissible. So observing hijab before non-mahram is compulsory, it's wajib. Any physical contact with non-mahram is unlawful. We all know that. Okay. So that is pretty much what I wanted to explain here today. Give you a brief introduction of Islamic studies, what I plan to achieve, what the structure is going to be. So what we're going to start with, hopefully, next time, is we're going to start with the jurisprudence of worshipping. We're going to start with taqleed. That is going to be our first course on taqleed. Then we're going to have rules concerning lavatory. What are the najis things? What are the purifiers? What makes something pure? What are the conditions of purifying water? There's going to be a demonstration of wudu, inshallah. What are the obligatory baths? Ghusl janaba, how it's done. Ghusl mayyat, how that's done. How to do tayammum. What is salat, how to perform salat. What are the conditions of dress code during prayer? The times of salat and how to determine them. How to determine the qibla. What are the pillars of obligatory acts of salat, the rukun of salat. Rules of place of prayer. All these things are mentioned in the Tawzul Masail. We have access to that. But going through this process in a structured manner, inshallah, all of us can obtain that knowledge. Rules of a masjid, what to do and what you can't do. Rules of prayer, the takbir, the ruku, the rules of jamaat prayers, the demonstration of salat will be done inshallah, praying and fasting in areas which are above and below the equator where you are not able to see the sun or the times are not, you cannot identify them, how to sight the moon, the rules regarding fasting, the rules of how to fast and the rules that are the jurisprudence of fasting. There will be a course on khums, there will be a course on hajj, misconceptions about jihad, there will be a course on that, and there will be a course on the language of clothing for men and for women, inshallah. So we are going to start with taqleed from next time inshallah, which is in itself a whole course. It will range from about 30-45 minutes to an hour, depending on the, if there are any questions and answers. So that's all I wanted to present today. What my intention is, that inshallah we can embark on this journey together. And it all depends on feedback from you and your intentions and if you are interested to know this. I am available. I will be creating these lectures based on the content that I have. Make it as interactive as possible so that people don't get bored, because that's the first thing that happens. And I know that. It happens with me also. Make it interactive. Get people who are in the audience involved. And inshallah, we'll get to a point where we can ask questions, we can have answers to questions. If I don't have the answer, Maulana Saab can answer those questions right away. But the point is to learn together, to strengthen our knowledge, to work on our amal, and inshallah become good Muslims. Because remember that inshallah we pray for the reappearance of our Imam. But can we actually say right now that as a community we are ready to face the Imam? I don't think so. And we can only do that if in our community we have things apart from just the big mans. We have people who are involved, who are learned, who help each other, and who are actually, we are working towards hosting the Imam inshallah in our community. Allah.